giant voice.
The official podcast of the U.S. Navy's largest overseas installation, Commander Fleet Activities Yokosuka. This is the Giant Voice Podcast.
Hello, welcome back to the Giant Voice Podcast. I'm your host today, MC2 Houghtaling, and today we're talking about saving money. Ask any sailor that has PCS'd before and they'll tell you, PCSing can get very, very, very expensive. And one of the things we want to cover in our Welcome Aboard mini-series is making sure that sailors know what resources they have to lift that financial burden off their shoulders when they're moving to or from CFA. So to talk about that today, we have a couple guests today. We have Caroline Coffer. She's the director of the Navy Marine Corps Relief Society Yokosuka office. We have Germaine Moore, who is the accredited financial counselor and personal financial manager for Fleet and Family. And finally, we've got two sailors from Yokosuka's Regional Support Center. That's PS1 Ponce and PS2 Flynn. Without further ado, I hope you enjoy the episode and learn a little something. Our first guest today is Germaine Moore. She's the accredited financial counselor and personal financial manager at Fleet and Family Support Center. How are you doing today, ma'am?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing great. So could you tell me a little bit about your job here at CFA?
Sure. I am the, like you said, the accredited financial counselor who oversees the personal financial management program. What I do at Fleet and Family Support Center is to ensure that our sailors and their families have the financial resources in order for them to make an educated decision when it comes to their finances. I also provide counseling session, free counseling sessions for the community. I also provide resources, refer them to the appropriate community partners, and provide training and financial education. So I also provide training for the command financial specialist, who pretty much will do the same same role that I have in Fleet and Family. They do the same thing at their command.
Thank you. So could we get into some of those resources that FFSE offers to sailors?
Sure. When it comes to finances, we have vetted websites, that government websites that they can utilize that is especially useful for their situation, understanding the benefits, their pay, the options that they can take advantage of to get more understanding with their military lifestyle. We have Military OneSource, who is pretty much the virtual option for them that is similar to the resources, referrals, trainings that we offer at Fleet and Family Support Center as well.
Thank you. And what about during PCS season? Do you have anything in particular that covers that area?
Yes. So when it comes to financial training, we also offer the PCS training. We offer that through our Touchpoint curriculum. This Touchpoint curriculum, for different stages of your personal and career milestones, this appropriate training is provided to you, such as your first duty station, your first time having a baby or getting married, and as well as the PCS, since everybody will be going through that. And if you are part of a command who will be deploying, we also offer pre and post deployment and provide an understanding of your retirement when it comes to blended retirement system and your TSP. And those are just some that we offer.
Thank you. And let's see. Do you have any tips or strategies for managing finances during a PCS move?
Yes. The most important thing is to create a plan. Mm-hmm. Understanding your current situation now and also projecting the changes that will come. There's going to be changes for your income. There will be changes for the expenses. And start doing that homework. Start doing your research. Contact your sponsor. Contact Fleet and Family Support Center and talk to the command financial specialist. They would be able to provide the resources that they need to create this plan. There will be unexpected expenses that will come with PCS. So understanding what that could potentially be, especially PCSing to Yokosuka, there's many changes that happens all the time, and to just be fully prepared for any of those changes.
Thank you. Is there anything else you'd like me to discuss or maybe talk about in regards to some of the services you offer?
Yes. So for Flynn families, the PFM program, we offer free counseling, and you don't have to have a problem when it comes to your money. Mm-hmm. I encourage being proactive with your money, with your creating a plan, financial plan for you and your family. Becoming financially ready will make you also mission ready. So that also contributes to your career and also for your family, building that generation wealth. So understanding where you are now so that you can achieve those financial goals that you have set for yourself and for your family in the future.
Thank you. And last question is, if a sailor is interested in this stuff and would like to contact you, how do they contact you?
So they can email me directly, Germaine, G-E-R-M-A-I-N-E dot M-O-R-E 3.ctr at us.navy.mil. They can also email our Facebook, our General Flynn Family Support Center email, ffscinfo@us.navy.mil, or they can give us a call, 243-3372. We also have a Facebook page and an Instagram page, and they're welcome to follow us there so that they can also see the free trainings that we provide. These are all free resources, free services to our family members that we encourage them to take advantage of so that they can have options, live a less stress lifestyle.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. That's all I had.
Okay. Thank you.
Very short, very, very quick.
And that's it for our first guest. Thank you very much. Moving on, we'll be changing gears a little bit to talk about some benefits you can receive from the Regional Support Center. And joining me from that office is PS1 Ponce and PS2 Flynn. Could you tell me a little bit about what you do there?
So I'm PS1 Ponce. I've been in the Navy for about 8 years. I spent most of my time in the Navy stationed in Japan. So I've been in Japan since 2018. So I've been out here for about 3 tours now. Started off on a small boy. I was on USS Barry, DDG-52, home ported to Washington, I believe. And then from the USS Barry, I transferred over to Comp 7 Fleet, where I was with the staff for about 3 years. I did that. And then I just PCS'd over to Regional Support Center Yokosuka, which is this brand new concept. The concept of the Regional Support Center is to provide training and insight for CPPAs and just to kind of liaise for the CPPA and advocate for them and just kind of be their voice. Also to kind of provide training to the TSC clerks to make sure they're following the proper procedures when processing any kind of entitlements.
And I'm PSU Flynn. I've been in for 9 years. I've originally started as an undesignated seaman. I struck PS and got stationed in Sasebo, Japan, spent 3 years there and moved to Guam, and now currently stationed at RSC Yokosuka.
Nice, thank you. So can you tell me a little bit about what you folks do at the Regional Support Center?
So the purpose of the Regional Support Center is to kind of assist CPPAs and to provide guidance. So recently, being a CPPA myself, I kind of understand the struggles of being a CPPA, you know, being in a job where you don't quite understand how to do something. And to be that lifeline for CPPAs, to someone to reach out to and ask for more guidance on how to do something or to ask for training. So, for instance, I'll use an example. There's an LS1 that I've actually developed a pretty good relationship with in Sasebo, and he calls me regularly just asking for guidance on how to do pretty much anything from an extension or, you know, how to process a TLA claim or something. And I kind of empathize for, you know, a lot of the CPAs because some of them are out of rate. They're not admin rates. So you have your LSs, you have your RSs, we got, you know, BMs, and they don't really know what they're doing. So us being there for them and to provide that insight and to provide guidance on how to do something. I mean, for a PS or a YN, it's common knowledge, but for people out of rate, it's not a common knowledge thing. So just being there for them, providing that training and that helping hand is our job. And also to kind of qualify sailors, you know, to get their CPPA phase two, you know, so they can start doing their own like red DAs and kind of keep that in-house. just to sort of give that power back to the CPPAs as well as the PSs that are on the ships.
Thank you. Thank you. So to get into all this, my first question is, what are some entitlements that sailors and their families get when they, you know, they start PCSing to Yokosuka? Like, what is available to them through your office?
So for entitlements, so let's say we have a sailor and their family coming from CONUS to OCONUS. So one of the entitlements that a sailor and their family could be entitled to is TLE, which is temporary lodging expense. So a TLE is an allowance designed to partially reimburse a service member for the cost of lodging and meals when he or she or dependent occupies temporary lodging in the continental United States. During a PCS move, use the actual amount without rounding when computing TLE allowances. So temporary lodging expense may be authorized up to 7 to 14 days, depending on the location of the new permanent duty station. For more insight on that, refer to the JTR, Joint Travel Regulation, Table 5, TAC 1-3. So that'll provide you more of the rules and the exceptions, the if and or buts.
Do you think people have any sort of misconceptions about saving money during relocation?
Yes and no. So sometimes people just, they're not aware of certain processes. So for instance, let's say a sailor is going from, you know, I don't know, somewhere in the States to Japan. A lot of the times they want to like buy their own plane ticket and that's not authorized. You know,
yeah, that's kind of stuff, I mean.
So a couple things that I've seen, a couple transactions is a sailor bought their own plane ticket and used their government travel card. Mm-hmm. So that's a big thing. And a lot of people are under the impression it's like, well, I bought my own plane ticket because, you know, NAVPTO didn't book me the flight I want. It's like, I get that's not really convenient for you, but that's not really an exception, or that's not really like, yeah, you know, that's not okay for you to buy your own plane ticket, you know. So the use of the GTCC is not authorized for procurement of commercial air for PCS travel. All commercial airfare for PCS travel will continue to book through your NAVPTO transportation office. So let's say you didn't want to fly out on a specific day. A lot of people don't understand that they'll try to book you the flights based on the AMC-like schedule. So for instance, Yokota's AMC schedule is Thursdays and Saturdays. Mm-hmm. And let's say somebody wants to try to transfer from their command on a Monday or something like that. Unfortunately, because the flight's not till Thursday or Saturday, you're just kind of in that area of, you know, burning your leave. So a lot of people, they don't quite understand that. They'll try to buy their own plane ticket to kind of like prevent that. Understand is what they can do is they can sort of adjust like their detached date to match their flight date, which is something I usually recommend. So you're not wasting money, you know, in the lodge. Because mm-hmm. once you detach from your command, like a TLA entitlement, you're not authorized because you're already in a transient status. So because of that, you wouldn't be entitled to TLA. And a lot of people don't understand that. They think, oh, well, I detached from my command, I moved out of my house. That doesn't mean you're authorized like a TLA because you're already receiving your transient allowances.
Okay. So my last question is just about like when you work there, do you get a lot of questions about stuff? You know, sort of repeat questions that you get a lot that you might want to explain on air so that way we can, you know, make sure that people hear about this?
Yes. One of the common things that we see a lot are people don't understand is like for DEA and FEA, which is your dependent entry approval and your family entry approval. So there's a lot of like misconception on where to send your requests to.
Right.
So before, I want to say prior to October 1st of last year, the TSC was doing all the approvals and the reviews for, you know, your command sponsorships, your DEA, FEA requests, your non-concurrent travels. But that actually changed to the area or installation commander, and that's effective October 1st of 2023. So for us, sailors coming from whatever activity to Yokosuka, they would have to send their request to CFA admin, and the CFA admin folks are the ones who would review and approve your DEA, FEA, and your command sponsorships and all that stuff. And with that being said, too, another thing that I see commonly is people get married to, let's say, a local national.
Right.
And they're like, oh, well, I was married for a year and I'm not getting my proper COLA entitlement. And the reason why they're not getting their COLA entitlement is because their dependents are not command sponsored. So in order to receive any sort of entitlement for your dependents, even for TLA, your dependents must be command sponsored. So even once you get the command sponsorship, you do have to kind of do the necessary paperwork just to kind of update those entitlements, you know, trigger that sort of mechanism. You know, obviously update your Red DA, your dependency application, you know, because without the proper paperwork, if your paperwork's out of date, then we can't really, you know, start your entitlements. That's why I always tell, like, sailors or in general, it's always important to update your Red DA, whether it's for PCS, transfer, marriage, divorce, you know, whatever it may be. It's always important to kind of make sure that your Red DA is up to date.
Got it. Thank you. Is there anything else you either of you'd like to add? You guys got scripts.
I wrote 3 pages because how intensive this was going to be.
It's just a brief overview of what you guys do. So
okay,
I appreciate the thoroughness, though.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I didn't know what to expect. So I was I'd rather be overprepared than underprepared.
Yeah,
you know?
I gotcha.
One thing I also wanted to talk about is TLA stuff. So I wanted to kind of hit back on TLA. So a lot of people don't know the timeline for TLA. So members are required to start seeking permanent housing as soon as possible after arrival. So after the end of the first TLA period, the designated overseas commander has the member's case reviewed to determine the progress being made toward obtaining permanent housing. The member's efforts appear deficient. The member is reminded of responsibilities in the matter. Unexcused failure to comply with a diligent search for requirement is cause to terminate TLA. So what that's saying is, if you're not kind of showing the housing office that you're actively looking for permanent residence, whether that's on base or off base, then they'll kind of cut your TLA entitlement off, meaning like you won't be reimbursed for those days and you're just going to be out of pocket.
Thank you very much. And for our final guest, we have the director of the Navy Marine Corps Relief Society's Yokosuka office. Is that correct?
Yes.
Hey, nice to meet you. So could you tell me a little bit of what you do at the office?
Yeah, absolutely. So NMCRS provides support for both Navy and Marines and their families through financial assistance and then our education programs. So the most common program that folks use is our Quick Assist Loan Program. That's up to $1,000, 0% interest-free loans, and folks are able to take those out over 5 times over their military career. Outside of our Quick Assist Loan Program, we provide 0% interest-free loans for a variety of situations, basically focused around needs-based assistance. So this would include emergency leave, rent, cell phone bills, car repair, funeral assistance, and many, many others. We absolutely encourage folks to give us a call or stop by our office to discuss their situation with us, and we can determine the best way that we can assist folks.
Thank you. What about classes? Do you offer any classes?
Yes, we do. So we have a Budget for Baby program. It's a 2-hour brief on how finances change when you bring a new addition into your family.
Right.
At the end of the class, participants do receive a $50 Amazon gift card, a blanket made by our volunteers, and then a resource packet full of tons of helpful information. So we also have a visiting nurse program. She provides home visits, office visits, and virtual visits to address any questions service members and their families might have. And she also does newborn family visits. She is currently co-facilitating the Pregnancy and Infant Loss Support Group, and she will be starting up a breastfeeding class at Atsugi soon.
Thank you. Are there any resources or classes that you offer that you feel might be underused by people here at CFA?
Yeah, and then specifically related to PCS, too, as we were talking about earlier. So for TLE, TLA, if a service member brings in their unpaid, I want to highlight unpaid bill from the Navy Lodge for that 10-day cycle, we can provide a check for directly to the Navy Lodge to cover that until the service member receives their entitlement, and then they come in and they pay us back. We call that a bridge loan. So we kind of bridge the gap until they receive that entitlement.
Thanks. Okay, so let's see.
I've got a couple more. I just need to breathe. I always forget to breathe when I talk.
I know, right? Okay, so.
So we also assist with Okonis pet travel. So if service members and their families are bringing pets from Okonis to Conner, it can get very expensive. So we can provide 0% interest-free loans to help with the costs associated there. And then also we provide another bridge loan for advanced OHA. So it can be very expensive to start up an off-base lease. So, for example, an E4 might see about $5,500 just to go live off-base.
Yeah.
So while they're applying for their advanced OHA from their command and waiting for that, we can also provide a bridge loan to get them out of TLA and out into their house. And then again, once they receive that entitlement back, they will come in and pay us back for that as well.
Thank you. Thank you. The script here mentions an active duty fund drive. Did you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah. So the active duty fund drive in support of NMCRS has officially kicked off. It runs through the end of April. And each command has a key person that is assigned, and they're dedicated to sharing about our programs that I just talked about and ways that service member ways that service members can donate back to us. Last year, in 2023, Yokosuka provided $1.5 million in financial assistance, which was 30% more than 2022. So there is definitely a need for our services. And so because the majority of our organization is supported by dedicated volunteers, more than 3,000 of them, 90 cents of every donated dollar goes right back into the programs that I just talked about earlier and for the service members and their right. families.
Okay, thank you. That's just about everything I had. Is there something you think I missed you wanna talk about?
Yeah, there's one more thing I would like to add that has to do with PCS and just in general with finances. In addition to our financial services and education programs, we also offer what we call a non-financial assistance, which is where service members will come in and do a budget with us. So if they're going through a transition, you know, going OCONUS to CONUS, and they want to see how their finances are going to shift with their different entitlements, or they just want to understand where their money is going, or maybe they have goals for the future that they're trying to save for, they can come in and have a conversation with our caseworkers, and we can work with them to help them identify how they can reach those goals or how those changes are going to impact them.
Thank you. If a sailor would like to, or their family would like to contact your office, do you have a contact number or something like that?
Yeah. So they can call us at 243-7905. That's our DSN number. And we always have taken walk-ins as far as having a initial conversation.
Right.
And we are located in the CRC building on the third floor in suite 313.
Thank you very much. Okay. That's everything I had. Did you guys have anything?
I want to say it was about like the housing, you know, the OHA and like the advanced OHA stuff. That's another thing that I see a lot of issues with is a lot of the sailors, they don't do the right order of the process to start their advanced OHA. They'll like write up their request sheet and they'll provide their selection or rental agreement thing, which is it's between the member and the real estate agent. They'll turn that in with like their request sheet, and they assume that's how their advanced OHA gets paid out.
So and how then, should they do it?
So the way it works is you get that rental agreement with the real estate agent, take that back with you to the housing office, and you just kind of schedule an appointment with the housing office, and then you say, this is the place I want to move in. And then the housing office will then ask, would you like to request for advanced OHA? Or is this something okay. that you're willing to kind of pay out of pocket up front and then, you know, when you move out, be reimbursed that? So a lot of them, what they do is they just turn in some of the paperwork, assuming that that's how the advance comes through. But you have to receive your housing memorandum, which is the breakdown of the advance OHA. It breaks down, like, you know, the amount and why they're requesting that prompt. And that's the amount they're going to put on their request sheet when they do write up that paperwork to be signed off by their chain of command. So one of the obstacles that we also see, too, in regards to the housing allowances is different installations have different policies, procedures on how they do housing stuff. Sasebo might have a completely different way of doing OHA. For instance, requesting for advanced OHA, I think they were the ones that require at page 13 on paying back OHA, whereas Yokosuka, we normally don't ask for the advanced OHA page 13, you know, saying I'm going to pay out X amount, you know, per whatever timeline. And that's sort of the obstacle that we face at the TSCRC is just not everyone does everything the same thing. And there's this sort of trying to learn everybody's process. So hopefully at some point they'll streamline that. Everyone's on the same page, because that's one of the issues that some sailors from Atsugi, you know, Okinawa, Sasebo,
yeah,
they
people
get
got a slightly different system.
Right.
Okay. And so what would you recommend a sailor do to stay informed about this kind of thing?
One thing that they can do is reach out to their RSC or TSC, or even try to reach out to the housing office and ask them like what their procedure is or what their policy is and how they streamline, you know, the process of triggering OHA or advance OHA, you know, what documentations are required from you, the housing office, to be given to the RSC, TSC to be processed.
Okay. Well, that's all I got. Thank you guys so much. And that's the episode. I hope you learned a little bit about savings and hopefully sign up for some of these classes and benefits. If you have any questions, comments, or even any episode ideas, message us on Facebook at the Commander Fleet Activities Yokosuka Facebook page, or email yokosukareport@gmail.com. This is MC2 Houghtaling signing off. Thank you for listening.
The Giant Voice Podcast is a production of Commander Fleet Activities Yokosuka Public Affairs Office. The views expressed in this podcast do not necessarily reflect the policy of the Department of the Navy or Department of Defense. Thanks for listening.